And welcome to the very first real conversations across the state, great state of Mississippi, with Roger Simpson and myself, Angela Buckner. And this show is going to be very, very epic on today. My name again is Angela Buckner. If you're out there and you know me, please, I always ask that you please subscribe to the Themicmagazine on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok. Roger Simpson, will you please introduce yourself on Real Conversations?
What's happening, Mississippi land? This is Roger Simpson, co-anchor with my cousin, Miss Angela Buckner. We are here with Real Conversations across Mississippi. Across Mississippi. So anything go. Anything go. And I'm going to let her introduce our luxurious guest today.
And on today, we're going to get right down to it. We have none other than Mr. Super Bowl winner, Mr. Tampa Bay Buccaneer winner. Let me stop moving my head so much. Defensive tackle, Super Bowl 37 champion, Ellis Wyms from Indianola, Mississippi. He also played with Seattle Seahawks and Minnesota Vikings, if I'm not mistaken. We're going to let Ellis come on in and tell us a little bit about who he is.
Hey, how y'all doing today?
Hey, Ellis.
It's a privilege to be here on the inaugural show. Jumping this thing off. Always good to connect with the home team. You know, us from the I-town, from Gentry High School. Again, it's great to be here. Great to get a chance to kind of launch this show with you guys. It's an exciting time in sports right now. So good to get a chance to just talk a little football. Talk a little bit about my time in the Delta. Of course, growing up with you guys and around you guys. So we'll have a good show.
And thank you so much for that. And with that being said, I have a video clip. Yes, we put together a video clip for you guys to watch. In case you think I'm up here and I'm lying about who Ellis Wyms is. Because see, that boy can knock a cow out. Yeah, I think when he was playing, you know, and training, and he's going to tell us a little bit about who his coaches were in a second. But I believe they had him out there on 448. And that's the Indianola joke.
Oh, yeah. I spent a little time out there on 448 out there in the country a little bit.
But yes,
people don't understand that it's a country part of the country. So
that's right.
And 448 is the country part of the country. So, yeah, I spent a little bit of time out there on 448.
Don't forget about me now. Kenlock Road, baby. Kenlock Road.
Already. I tell people, hey, cotton fields and catfish ponds all day.
Yes, come ma'am. On. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yep. And so with that being said, thank you for acknowledging that there is a country part of the country. We're getting ready to play a video so you guys can actually relive with us the moments that Ellis will be sharing about what it was and how he got started with football instead of basketball, because he was all American too. Don't play.
Yeah.
Okay, so give us a second, guys, and we're gonna load that up for you right about now.
Play fake and down he goes. Ellis Wyms, the second year defensive end out of Mississippi State with the sack.
Looks to escape, wrapped up, and taken down. Ellis Wyms, off by Simeon Rice.
Joe, there's the big mistake you talked about.
Well, and he's lucky.
get the ball back, what you think of in this situation, you turn the ball over to Tampa Bay on the 35, they're going to get something out of it. Warren Sapp just pushes his way through on Kevin Dogans and then tries to get in and make the recovery. Elias Flynn knocks it out of his hands.
From the 18, Gannon again going to work with less than 5 minutes remaining in the third, and it just continues. This time it's Ellis Wyms with the sack.
Here, let's watch it.
Play action. Carter in trouble. Down he goes. Lost the football. Ellis Wyms with his second sack of the season. Third down at 5. Horton in trouble. Down he goes. Ellis Wyms with his first sack of the season. Pressure came right up the middle from Ellis Wyms, number 96.
It did, but I'll tell you what.
Okay.
that made me want to see can I suit up again.
I'm putting the chills in.
I'm ready to get back out there. I might have to unretire.
All right, they're gonna give you a 1 year contract at a time.
Hey, I probably can't go but one day right now. So that year would be too long.
Marshawn Lynch did it.
Hey, that's beast mode, man.
Beast mode
built differently. So that's something serious.
Let me ask you something, Ellis. So while I was watching that video, I saw you sitting there, you know, in that, that's the picture that they took. What was going on that day that you took that picture? Do you remember?
Which one?
In your jersey.
In my jersey? Oh, yeah, that was the... That was when you first report. You know, after you get drafted, you first report. You know, they make you put on a little jersey. They notice they didn't have no number on there because you know they weren't sure I was gonna be around that long. So I was a sixth round pick, man. I had to go in there and fight for everything I got. That was when you first report and they give you a jersey and you take that first picture as a member of the team. So yeah, that was pretty cool.
And I was wondering. I said he doesn't look too happy about it, but I know he's glad to be there. I didn't know what happened that day, but thanks for sharing that. Look, tell us, how is it that you knew that you wanted to play football as opposed to basketball?
You know what? I play both. You know, I play football, I play basketball. Of course, I love playing basketball for Coach Hick, but you know, I have better opportunities in football. Right, okay. So you got a smaller school that's going to tell you, you know, okay, you can come in and play basketball, but you know, it's Jacksonville State, or you can go to Mississippi State and play in the SEC and play football. You know, I love me some basketball, but I got to get this money right now. So,
right,
I chose football.
Now, let's talk about your background with your coaches at Gentry High School, and I want you to talk a little bit about how they help to cultivate that greatness within you. And I know that my co-host Roger Simpson was one of those coaches.
Oh yeah, man. You know, it was a blessing to have so many good men you know, around me when I was growing up, going through high school. Again, you know, Roger, you know, one of our coaches, Coach Harris, Coach Geis, Coach Calhoun, Coach White, Coach Sheldon from the junior high. You know, Coach Hickenbottom. Back then, Coach Hick coached football when I first got there. So, you know, these were not only, you know, our coaches, they were teachers, they were pillars of the community. You know, they were really, really good men. And the one thing about playing for those guys is you were going to work really, really hard. You were going to work hard. You were going to show up and you were going to get your work in and they were going to hold you accountable. So, you know, they just prepared me to go to the next level and just be willing to do the work, right? Just show up and no matter how hard it is, you just show up and do the work and whatever happens, happens.
You know, and that's what I want to kind of, and that's what I want to kind of elaborate on.
We have a comment here from Aura Stark. She said, Ellis Wyms, a powerhouse. Seeing those clips got me ready for game day.
Yeah, I appreciate that, Aura. Hey, appreciate it. It got me ready, too. So we both ready to go.
But, you know, like I said, like what I was getting ready to say, Ellis, you know, you had that intestinal fortitude back then. I mean, you wanted to do it. You weren't staying in the back of the line. You was always first in every drill that we did. And you just gave that intestinal fortitude to make it happen. And that what made you so great. Well, I already knew you were destined for greatness. Wow. Because that's just how you presented yourself, even in practice. And you just excelled once the game started. Hey, once that clock came on and them lights came on, baby. Hey, on that Gentry High field, it's on. It was on.
It's time to go represent them Rams, man. Yes, you know, sir. I was nowhere nearly, I think, like the most talented guy to ever come through Gentry High School and play football. There were some really, really great athletes that I played with, that you played with, Roger. And I tell people all the time, you know, I was the guy that just showed up and did what I had to do. You know, like I got good grades. So when it was time to get a scholarship, I could receive it. Right. When it was time to work out or go to practice, you didn't have to look for me. Like, you knew I was going to be there, and I was going to show up. And, you know, during that time, you know, it was we would have maybe, you know, start the season with 80 guys on the team. You know, but we get to the last week of the season, we got 25 guys, you know, you know, playing the last game. So it was, you know, that part of it being willing to show up, it was times, you know, when I would – you know, I don't know if you showed up on one of them calls, Roger, but the police showed up a couple of times because I broke in the gym. You know, I crawled through that window in the coach's office to work out when nobody was there, right?
You remember that window? You
know, fly through that coach's window, go through that little training room right there.
Yes, sir.
And police showed up a couple of times, like, you know, because it seemed like somebody had broken the school, but it's just me in here working.
And put your time in, baby. Put your time in.
So being willing to show up, man, was the biggest part.
And that speaks a lot to your work ethic. Letting people know that, hey, I'm going to get my work in. I'm going to get this conditioning and strengthen as much as possible because I'm dedicated to the cause. Yep. And that's the way teams actually operate. Look, let's talk right quick about Tampa Bay. Tampa Bay is going back to the Super Bowl. The first time they went is when you were there. And after watching those clips, I said, man, this boy, and I had to jog my memory. I said, he played with Warren Sapp. Y'all were beast mode before beast mode.
You know, number one run defense.
Yeah, we were the number one defense in the league that year. But I was lucky. You know, you always want to get drafted higher, but I got drafted in the sixth round, and I got drafted to a place where it was a winning culture. And I played with players like Warren Sapp and Derrick Brooks and John Lynch and Rondé Barber and Simeon Rice and played for Coach Tony Dungy. I got drafted into a culture that really taught me how to be a pro. And it was a blessing to get a chance to just be on that team and get a chance to be a part of it.
That's awesome. And, you know, I noticed in the clip, they say, Ellis Wyms, Mississippi State. How does it feel to know that you are part of, you know, the SEC prior to that, because a lot of people feel that they need that extra oomph to get into the football, National Football League. Talk a little bit about Mississippi State and how it grew you up. Were you afraid to leave Indianola, Mississippi?
Oh, man, yeah. When my mom dropped me off of that dorm room, like, I cried. Like a baby. Wow. Like, when she finally left, you know, she drove me up there, took me with all my stuff, took me shopping, got my dorm room set up. And when she left, I'm like, oh, my God. Like,
yes.
For me, like, going to Greenville was a trip. Like,
yes.
going 30 minutes up the road to Greenville or going to Jackson was just to go to the mall was huge.
Yes.
So getting taken, you know, from home, you know, out of my comfort zone and dropped off at Mississippi State, it was tough. But, you know, I went in, I adjusted. Again, I always had a good work ethic. So that'll always save you anywhere you go. It'll help you fit in when you're willing to show up and work through the hard times. Because there are definitely some tough times where you're going to question, like, can I do this or should I be here? And I just fought through it. So but Mississippi State was an awesome experience.
When I think of Mississippi State, see, I went to Mississippi Valley State University, right? And I remember going to visit some of my sorority sisters, the Zetas, you know, Zeta Phi Beta and Phi Beta Sigmas. And man, when I got to Mississippi State campus, it was too big. I said, oh, I don't know how Ellis and the rest of them do it. Didn't Tyrone Washington go too?
Yeah, Tyrone was there when I was there. Tyrone was a junior when I got there.
Okay.
Me and Tyrone, I spent a lot of time in his apartment. You know, I don't know if y'all know Garrett Riley, but Garrett Riley, his uncle was Johnny Cooks, and Johnny Cooks was from Leland, and he went to Mississippi State. He played on the New York Giants Super Bowl team, but he was a part of the athletic department there. So his nephew Garrett we graduated class of '97 together. He went up there with me. So I had Tyrone and I had Garrett. So I had some of the home team there. Derek Brown, you know, Coach Elum's son. Derek Brown was up there.
Yeah.
So, you know, we were well represented up there, and that helped me out a lot because, again, the campus was huge, a totally different environment. But they helped me kind of, you know, find my way.
So now let's talk about the Tampa Bay experience. Now you're in a totally different state.
Right? Yeah. Yeah.
Now that should be a culture shock within itself. Talk about getting off the bus or out of your car. How did you get there? I mean, put us there.
Well, you know, I drove. I jumped in my Navigator, and I took that, you know, that 17-hour drive, and I drove down to Tampa with all my stuff in the truck. There, first of all, just first time really just being around a beach.
Wow.
So just going into a different place, a different world, a bigger city, and not just visiting, but having to live there. Because up until that point, like, I really had never traveled anywhere but Mississippi unless Mississippi State was going somewhere to play a football game. That's the only time I had ever really traveled out of the state. I went to high school there. I went to college all 4 years there. So that's all I knew. I just got there. And Tampa's a beautiful city. It's still in the South. So, you know, people were nice. The weather's always beautiful. And honestly, I just enjoyed being in that state. Like, I could have been in Buffalo. Where it's freezing cold. I could have been in, I'm in Tampa, Florida. And on top of that, I'm with a great organization around a bunch of great players. So it just worked out.
Who did you bond with initially?
You know, there's one of my teammates that was on our Super Bowl team. His name is Chuck Darby. Now, Chuck went to South Carolina State. And he's a country boy like me. No, he's from North South Carolina. So we kind of shared some of the same life experiences as far as, you know, the food, the culture, the family, the music. So we bonded right away. He had been there a year before me as a rookie, but he was coming back from NFL Europe. So he was just getting back and both of us were trying to make the team. So we ended up being roommates. And it was kind of like having somebody with the same life experience, with the same thing on the line, but we both come from nothing. And we just bonded over there. You know, we just encourage each other to fight every day, to fight through the pain, to fight through the injuries, to fight through the soreness, to being tired, to getting yelled at, 125-degree heat. We just bonded. We still great friends to this day.
Ellis, when you got that jersey with your number on it, what did it mean to you?
Man, it was a dream come true. You know, it's what you dream about when you're playing in the front yard as a kid. You know, as a kid, I'm pretending to be, you know, Walter Payton, pretending to be Jerry Rice. The first preseason game, when you put on that uniform and you walk out that stadium, and it's, you know, 70,000 people, and the people you're walking out there with are the guys you just got to know. The year before you're in college, you're playing the Madden video game, and you playing on the video game with Warren Sapp and Mike Allstott and Warwick Dunn. And then now it's like, I'm walking out the tunnel with these dudes.
Wow.
So that was a dream come true. It's like, you know, it's something you never forget.
Yes. Man, great. When I tell you, we are so proud of you. When, you know, I was in here setting up for an interview, and I told my husband, I said, Tampa's going to win. And he's a Tom Brady's guy. Because I dare not say a Patriots fan anymore.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
No.
No, you can't say that anymore.
So I told him, I said, babe, Tampa Bay is going to win this game. And so when they made the announcement, he said, I heard you coming. I heard you, baby. I said, didn't I tell you? And so were you sitting around watching that game? And tell us.
I got three young children. So we had, you know, some basketball with my 9-year-old. So I actually missed some of the first half.
Okay.
But I was able to get in and catch like the last part of it. And it came down to the wire, but I always had confidence because, again, when you got the GOAT on your team,
There you go.
And Tom just knows how to win, man. He just knows how to win. And I think he's got something to prove this year. So you know, it was great to just see the clock ticking down. And I remember that moment in Philly when we were kind of, you know, we were about to win the NFC Championship game and realizing that you're about to go to the Super Bowl. And it just took me back to that moment. So just great for those guys, great for those young players, great for Tom to get a chance to do this far along in his career. Just a testament to how great he is.
Hey, Ellis.
What's up?
I got to ask you that million-dollar question, man.
What's up?
I got to ask you that million-dollar question.
What it is? What you got?
Who team was that, Dungy or Gruden?
You know what, man? I get asked that question.
You don't have to ask it.
I ask that question a lot, man. And it's crazy because I got so much respect for both of them. Because, of course, you know, Coach Dungy drafted me. A lot of the culture that we were came from him, especially on defense. The defensive culture, identity, everything that we were, and it flowed from him. He took that team from being garbage. Like, Bucks were trash. And he took that team from that to a Super Bowl contender. Unfortunately, he couldn't see it through. But with John, what John brought was a different energy. Like, John is a super – he's a football coach, but he's a fan. And he's a huge fan of the game, and it comes out in everything he does. I know people see the scowl and, you know, hear him talk, but he's just really a guy that loves football. And honestly, the team kind of got a chance to exhale a little bit under John. It was a little less strenuous. Coach Dungy was like being in the military. This is what it is, and this is what we're going to do.
You're trying to be or something.
And I hear you might have some disruptions, but this is what we're going to do because this is what I believe. And John Moore kind of will listen to players and be like, okay, we're gonna back off a little bit. You know, we're going to chill out. And he brought a little bit more offensive pop. So I do believe what he brought to the table helped get us over the top. So it's both of them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's the way you're going to answer it, huh?
Yeah, man. You know, Yeah, hey, I had to pull out my politician face on that one, man.
You know, right.
I had to politic it a little bit, you know.
Now, Ellis, this is, from what I understand, the first time that Tampa will play the Super Bowl in Tampa. You guys played in San Diego. Where did you guys play the Super Bowl at?
We played in San Diego.
Mm-hmm.
Played in San Diego against the Raiders.
Yep.
Listen, on that video that I put together, who was that you had just tackled?
I think that was Rich Gannon. That was the quarterback for the Raiders in that game. Yeah, we got out to him pretty good. Yeah, they had a tough day at the office. So he saw me and he saw a whole lot of other folks that day. That put him. That was a great performance by our team.
Yo, that's right.
Tom Brady gives credit to the defensive linemen. Talk a little bit about Devin White.
Well, Devin White, young kid linebacker, reminds me a lot of Derrick Brooks with our defense and how he used to fly around and make plays all over the place. Their defensive front, though, with Shaq Barrett and Pierre Paul, Dominican Sue and Vita Bay, they're going to have to play a great game to have a chance to win in the Super Bowl. But they've been. They've been really, really putting their in the game in the offseason. And if they're going to have a chance to win, that defensive line is going to have to play great because they're going to have to put a lot of pressure on Patrick Mahomes to keep him from shredding the game.
Where do you see the defense need to buckle down more?
I think coverage-wise, they got some young defensive backs.
Yeah.
So those guys, I think they can cover. I think they're a good group of players, good group of athletes. But when the stage is that big, that's when mental errors tend to occur because there's so much attention and so the lights and what's at stake. So it'll be more about them not making mental mistakes, not having busted coverage, everybody kind of knowing, what page we're on, what defense we're on. And the defensive line, they got to hunt. Like, they got to get out to Mahomes. They got to put a lot of pressure on Mahomes all day. If they do that, they'll definitely have a chance to win. But they're going to have to put a lot of pressure on Patrick Mahomes.
Okay, definitely. Listen, now, we have right here in Mississippi, primetime, Deion Sanders. Mm-hmm. And he is moving forward. Their first game is supposed to be with Mississippi Valley State University.
Okay.
Hopefully I can get him on the show so we can, Roger and I can talk a little bit trash with him, But
he ain't going to talk about my alma mater. No.
Hey, y'all better get it together. The Delta Devils better get it together. Prime time coming.
Hey, we're doing a little recruiting. We're doing a little recruiting, baby. We're doing a little recruiting. We're going to be there.
Yeah, we're going to see.
We're going to show up. We might not show out.
Hey, the first rule, you got to show up. So we show up,
baby.
Then
you
gotta
show up.
Because Deion, the way he's talking, Deion ain't playing, as we say outside.
The one thing about football is games ain't won with talking.
That's right.
So we're going to see. He's a Hall of Fame player, Super Bowl champion. He's been around great coaches. Like when he was in San Francisco and being on those Super Bowl teams in Dallas and being on those Super Bowl teams, he knows what it takes to win. In college, again, it's all about the team you put together. If you put together a great coaching staff, you bring it in good players. The important thing about Prime, though, I think he understands the mentality of a winner.
There you go.
Hopefully, he can build that into his players, and I think he'll have some success.
Yes. Look, now, how would you feel about coaching on the collegiate level one day, maybe?
And,
I'm talking Mississippi State now.
You know what? Coaching on the collegiate level, I love football, but man, it takes a lot of your life. You had to commit your life to it. Yeah. And I got a pretty big family right now.
Okay.
I'm raising mine right now. When you're a college coach, you're recruiting. You're responsible for those kids you bring on that campus. They're 18 years old. They newly. And I remember because I was 18 years old and fresh from home. And they had to wrangle me up a couple of times. Like, what you doing? What happened? You know, like, it's so that's a lot of responsibility. So I love football, but, you know, I'm enjoying being a husband and a father and making sure my family is on solid footing right now.
Hey, oh, yeah, shout out to your wife. Shout out to your wife. Everybody is married, so you can't have
her. Oh, Miss Dee Dee Wyms. Yeah, that's my rock right there. That's my boss lady.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Ellis, it was so great having you here, speaking with us. What would you tell some students right now during the pandemic, you know, who are wanting to play? And, you know, I know my son played this year. Mm-hmm. And he's on the defense. He's a defensive lineman. What would you tell the ones now who are looking forward to next year?
I would say, you know, just continue to work. Focus on you right now. Focus on, you know, getting stronger, getting faster, making sure your grades are where they can be. Again, first and foremost, if you don't have, you know, a certain GPA, you don't make your ACT score. If you want to go to college, you know, that's held many a great athlete back.
Sure did. Sure have.
And so making sure you're just handling your business, focus on you and preparing yourself to be the best student and the best player you can be. And then whenever they roll the ball back out, make sure you stay ready. You ain't got to get ready. So
That's right.
Stay ready at this time and do the best you can with what you have with you. You know, that's the thing I think I did is I was able to do the best I could with what I had. And again, I want to make sure I mention this with our coaches, you know, and Roger, you know this, Coach Walter Jordan. Man, Coach Jordan, he became the head coach my senior year. He took me on his wing, mentored me, made sure I had whatever I needed, took me to Mississippi State, took me to Ole Miss, took me to Arkansas, made sure I was in the Mississippi-Alabama game, advocated for me every way he could to put me in position to be a Division I athlete. So always, especially when I'm talking, you know, at home, it's like, you know, giving people their props that did so much for me. God rest his soul. His wife, Mrs. Jordan, again, they were like a second set of parents to me through that time, through that year. And again, he treated me like his son.
Coach
Jordan. Coach Jordan was just a pillar of the community. His wife was a teacher, lived there in Indianola.
Coach Jordan used to drive a beer truck. Beer company. He just was a good pillar of the community.
Man, I wouldn't have been able to do anything. If he didn't advocate for me and take me where I needed to be, where people could see me and give me an opportunity, because recruiters didn't come to the Delta, not Mississippi State and Ole Miss. They didn't come down there looking for players, not too often. I think they do a little bit more now because they found some really good ones in there. But back then, that they wasn't just coming down to the Delta. You had to make yourself known, and he did that for me.
Shout out to Michael Spurlock.
Shout out to Mike Spurlock. You know, we both got big time Tampa Bay Buccaneer history. So, you know, he took the first kickoff in the history of the Buccaneers to the house. And I was on the Super Bowl team there. So it's crazy. Two guys that went to high school got historic ties to the same.
Exactly.
Shout out to Mike. How does it feel to know that they are going back? Does that bring back nostalgic memories, make you want to call up some of those teammates like Warren and others and say, man, we done did it?
You know what? I talked to Derek. Derek texted me yesterday. I always talk to Sam. Talk to Sam when I can find him. Where in the world is the bear today? He could be anywhere on the planet at any given time.
Listen, I noticed on when you would tackle, Warren Sapp would be the one like he'll hug you, or he'll high five you, he'll pat you on the back.
You know what? Warren
camaraderie.
And Warren was the engine that drove the car. You know, he was the engine behind a lot of what we did. Not just his play, but his energy, his personality. Like, you know, there's nobody else you would rather go into a fight with. than that dude.
Yeah,
Hall of Fame player, and he coming in to claim war, and you ready to roll with him? So that's the big. That's one of my big brothers, man. He mentored me and taught me a whole lot.
Yeah.
Super Bowl Sunday is February 7th. What will you be doing?
You know what? I'll probably be sitting on my couch with my boys watching it.
And cheering for who?
Oh, cheering for them Bucks, man. You know, cheering for them Bucks, man. We're gonna bring this thing home. You know, we got the new kid on the block versus the old sheriff. You know, so it ain't a new sheriff in town yet. That old sheriff, I think he's gonna come through for one last dance.
That's right. That's right.
And on that note, we want to close this out. Ellis, thank you so much for your time. We're not gonna hold you anymore. Man, whenever I need an interview, you always come through for me. I want to send a shout out to my Zeta Phi Beta sorority sister, Carmen Wyms. Thank you so much for the connection, Carmen. Shout out to your big sister.
When big sis tell me to do something, you know I gotta look out. So
there you go.
We got you.
And there you go. That's the word on the street. You better know it. You better call Carmen.
Yeah. Carmen, let me know what it is, and it's going to get done.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Roger, any final words?
Yeah, shout out to my two girls. I love y'all to death. Shout out to Omega Psi Phi. Shout out to Ellis. I mean, congratulations for everything and all your accomplishments.
Yes.
And like we said, real talk, real conversation across Mississippi.
Hey, one more thing. Every time we broke the huddle, I always threw up the I-town. Every time.
That's right. You showed me.
Any huddle, I'm throwing up the I-town. So hey.
I-town, baby.
All right, man.
And see you when you come home sometime, big guy.
All right. I hit you up. Thanks, Andrew. All right.
No problem. Thank you guys so much. And on that note, everybody, if you're out there, we just interviewed with Ellis Wyms, and this is our first show, and he was our first person, and we were so glad and so honored to have him on Real Conversations across the great state of Mississippi with me and Roger Simpson, my cousin. And so if you know someone out there who is looking to shine and wanting to have real conversation with us, let us know. On that note, we're going to say peace out.
Peace out, baby.
I'm gonna see y'all.
Yeah.